A very important development on bioterrorism to tell you about. Researchers in Wisconsin and the Netherlands working separately have created a form of the deadly bird flu virus that can easily spread from person to person. There is growing concern that if terrorists got their hands on this information, they could create a virus that could kill millions of people around the world. The bird flu virus, known as H5N1, is fatal in 60% of human cases. Since it was first detected back in 1997, about 600 people have been sickened by it. Of those, only 336 have died, mainly because it cannot yet be transmitted between humans. In response to the new research, the government's National Science Advisory Board for Biosecurity, for the very first time, has asked the journals Science and Nature to withhold certain details of the new research from reports they intend to publish. Joining us to talk much more about this is Dr. Michael Osterholm. He's the director of the Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy at the University of Minnesota School of Public Health. He's also a member of the National Science Advisory Board. Dr. Osterholm, nice to have you on the program.
Thank you very much. Good to talk to you again.
Thank you. You as well. What do you know about this new research? I mean, how significant of a discovery do you think this is?
Well, first of all, let me just add one disclaimer. As a member of the board, I can't get into the confidential nature of the work, but there's a fair amount of information that's in the public domain that I can talk about. Basically, the efforts were really to see if the H5N1 or bird flu viruses, which to date have not transmitted readily from person to person, as you noted, could actually go through a series of genetic changes that would actually make them capable of doing that and really becoming the next pandemic influenza strain. And what the authors were able to do in the two papers that are now being considered did demonstrate changes that could very well mean that the virus could become readily transmitted between humans.
So what do you say to critics who are saying that this is, in a sense, censorship, telling these journals that you can't publish this information, these findings?
Well, first of all, we all agree that kind of the ultimate original sin of scientific research is censorship. But we also understand that there is a way to move very critical information to those in the scientific world that have a need to know without informing the entire world. And what I mean by the entire world, particularly those individuals who may, for nefarious reasons, want to try to duplicate this work and that virus somehow get into the population. And I would really be mindful here that it's not just terrorists we think of. Even someone working with the virus in a laboratory where they are not sufficiently careful to keep it from escaping could very well be the reason why this could start another worldwide pandemic. So the efforts we really have undertaken is to try to find that right middle point. How do we make sure that the right information is moved to the people who have a need to know, but that it's not in the hands of those who could use it for unfortunate purposes?
How easily do you think this could get into the hands of terrorists or anyone who might want to do any harm with it?
Well, in the scientific world, openness is what we're all about. That's, in fact, how science moves forward, is to make sure that others can see what we did, how we did it, and have others duplicate it. And so, on the other hand, remember, physicists have been working with classified or secure data since the 1930s and 40s. We know that there have been other efforts in the life sciences, meaning biology, where we've worked with agents of bioterrorism that were done under research classifications of what's called classified. So it's not that this hasn't happened before. What we have to do now is realize that we suddenly really leapfrog over an infectious agent that we worried about but never thought it being a potential agent of intent to harm, and now being that. And so we're all working on how to try to find the best means to support this work, to make sure that it's done right, that it's done safely, mm-hmm. and that those who have a need to know, and those who don't
right.
won't get it into their hands. And I think that can be done.
So given the sticky situation that you seem to be in right now, I mean, do you have any thought that maybe this research shouldn't have been done in the first place? Any regrets?
Well, first of all, I think this research is very important for several reasons. One is that until now, there were a lot of people who doubted that H5N1 or the bird flu virus would ever become a pandemic influenza strain, meaning that circulates around the world among a largely unprotected population and causing great damage. Now we have no doubt. The changes that we know about that have allowed this virus to become more readily transmitted among ferrets, an animal model that really approximates what happens in humans, should be a clarion wake-up call to the entire world that tomorrow this particular flu virus could become the next pandemic and dwarf anything that we've seen in modern history. Second of all, it now does give us more information about how we might anticipate when another flu virus is moving towards becoming a pandemic strain? Are there markers in those viruses when we see them in animals, like birds, that should give us warning that maybe something's about ready to happen?
Yeah.
So this work does have real benefit, but we also recognize the downsides, and that's what the National Science Advisory Board was trying to do, was really use the wisdom of Solomon to accentuate the positive and to really minimize the negative.
Dr. Osterholm, great to have you on the show, and I hope to get back to your lab in Minnesota sometime very soon. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Randy. Good talking to you.